A lot of friends of on the faces on traction engines. As well, showing some friends around our little Eitel jet. Green Dawn on the left hand side, station steamroller owner. Right, is there any more on the rally? Right, now this is 1995. There's my BSA scooter, the white one. Yes.
But, no, not very many though, was it?
Not that early. This was an early BSA and they didn't do white until later on in the series. They did do a white one eventually. I liked it in white. This is our Lauretta Vega scooter as well. Remember that couple who had that collection of Honda coats? They were, we got to know them for a few years. They always had some very nice Honda coats. Alan's Trojan, looking a bit two-tone, but I think that's a trick of the video.
Yeah.
It's all yellow. I suppose it wasn't quite right on that. That's strange, it's supposed to do that. Free dog on that one.
We've got a nice little vestie.
So I hope that will be acceptable to all exhibitors and stewards, which will give us an afternoon of non-stop entertainment.
Yeah, I suppose it was a bit iffy at times, yeah. Destination on that green bus, High Street. Could be anywhere. High Street. And is that lovely PD2? Yeah, beautiful. I grew up in Plymouth when they had a lot of that model. I love that shape. Appear to have got a tape from 1994, and I remember one year the weather was so bad they actually had to cancel it out. I think that's probably why I've not got a video of 1994. Oh, there's that song that we saw in the area. Did you? In the area? From the years earlier, perhaps? That took some organising to get that transported to site and operational. Out driven by a traction engine. Yeah, there you go. compression engine working quite well, earnestly, but not going anywhere, just powering the accessories, as it were. I wonder if modern health and safety means that you can't use a hoverflying belt now exposed like that. We've seen this at various classic rallies in the past.
Yeah, but you see that at as well, didn't we?
Yeah, that's come off there, I think. Yeah, not seen it at recent rallies. Yes, if you happen to be standing near that belt, I suppose a rope will come off and potentially quite dangerous. Stretching over the front of the day. Nice
little
cue at the top. If you want to have a drive while the road mending is going on,
the road mending
is
drive over the... It's called volley, that one, too, would you believe it? Easy said than done, I think, getting that belt back on. And then, Chris's camper on the tripod. Now, I think this bus came up from Wintry, the Wintry collection.
And then finally, of our fire appliances, we have...
Exeter Corporation colours of those days. Look at this microphone there. This must have been... I think that... As a very keen enthusiast, or perhaps seeing the TV, I don't know. The wind noise on the microphone. Oh, yes, there was a company who used to make videos everywhere. Salmon, didn't they? That's right. I think they stopped doing it now because so many people could take their own videos.
Yeah.
In August, rather, or 21st of August, in 1992. It's quite nice to have them in the ring and to be able to say something about them rather than have them all just lined up on the park or on the field. So the first of our buses is a very, very well-known bus in preservation because owned by Colin Shears from Chumley, of course, Weekly. And this was really the bus that started him collecting buses. This was the bus that inspired his interest. Leyland Tiger... 1938, I'm not sure whether it's TF7 or TF8 from memory, but operated quite obviously by Exeter Corporation, and it was acquired by him in January 1957, and that's been in preservation for quite a long time. And what a super bus it is. It's a typical example of the Leyland single deck bus of the 1930s. And, type of bus that was around for so long because the arrival of the Second World War meant that many of these older vehicles had to soldier on almost literally long after they might normally have been fenced off. So many thanks to Colin Shears for bringing this vehicle here, and listen to the sound as it goes off. Deckers had a doorway rather than the double deck style open platform, but for city operation, for use, say, in a place like Exeter, well then the open platform was far more convenient for entrance and exit. And I think I've got a photograph that I took at Camerton back in about 1967 or 68 that really has been around on the roundfield for a long time. And the news fans, John, sadly, two terraces have been lost, a Lion King and another sort of blue-black one. If anybody sees a couple, and these are children's purses. We live in hope. If anybody finds the odd children's purse, the Lion King and another blue-black one, please bring them to the commentary box, please. There are a couple of sad children around at present, so if you can do that, we'd be grateful. A Lion King purse and another one which is a sort of blue-black type colour. We'll move on with our next bus in just a moment. I thought we got somebody called Percy around here that we lost for a minute.
No, I didn't think so.
Anyway, buses sometimes appear singly or appear in threes or
are intense, and the sense at the moment is that we're likely to at least appear in threes, because I think there are two more on the move, and we'll get to say something about them when they appear. But France here with a later model Hanskinson here. Only 7 years really separates the Bill Dacol family on that cab. This is Mark 1 of 1959, Gardner engine, Gardner 100, 5LW.
He's referring to some other bus, not this one.
I'll put the chicken in.
5 and 6LW engines.
Right.
But, very
going to get our dinner ready, I think.
That's
not the kind of buses.
Very useful for heavy recovery for the military. You notice he's got the spade that can be lowered in the back there to provide a retainer to stop it moving backwards when you're actually using the winch.
I see the duck on the top there. Appreciating that style.
Takes over almost in complete silence. And as usual, we have a member of the family there in the back. She's got a rifle today, so I made comments about it yesterday, so she's probably got the rifle to warn me to shut up today. Spirit of 44, I'm going to get this in the right order today. A very, very well-known jeep in this area, owned by Robert Golden Bobble from North Deswar, and Sharon driving it there. 1942, this is used on the Somerset farm, like so many of these wartime jeeps were from 1947. It now appears in the markings of the US 101st Airborne Division. And it's towing a 1943 Bantam trailer, the typical trailer that would have been carried around by jeeps in the Second World War. Carrying, of course, there the D-Day star, the Allied star, identification star.
Just before 8A, John, to say thank you to Sharon, the driver of number 8 as well, for providing the typescript for our programme this year at very short notice on a 1944 typewriter, no doubt.
A lady of many skills, yes. And
Here's the old man himself, Diane. No, we are grateful, though, yes.
It's a timeless design, I think. It's, you know, just about the ultimate Mars. Didn't like it when they panned over the radiator and lost a little character. Those were the days when Leyland was a great name. Lannis today, sadly. We had an outing yesterday into Sainsbury's in Bridgewater. A charter bus that comes along to take customers there, recently organised by Crossrail. They supplied a single-decker coach made in China. Very nice coach. But how things have changed. Chinese coach now, the local service. I noticed it was powered by a DAF engine now. I thought they disappeared, DAF from Holland. Guess it's just the name they use. Because Leyland got associated with DAF for a period, making vans and minibuses, but I didn't realise they still existed as an original friend of DAF. So there's me trying out my DSA scooter. I think Val must have taken this video. Because he was showing a picture as well. And that's an underdog on the front.
It is owned by Graham Steens. It's a Model C15, which is 250cc, 1959, purchased from Corbett, yes, hence his Corbett registration number, now owned by Graham Steens in King Stainton in South Devon. The 250 BSA, always very popular. This later one had an integral gearbox, and it's followed by number 14, Sunbeam Scooter, 1960 Sunbeam 250cc scooter, one of the relatively few British-made scooters. They were very much an Italian idea with Lambretta and Vespa, but in the late 50s, early 60s, some British competition did take place, and this is a 1960 Sunbeam 250cc on the new re-registration number, being a Mary Oliver's number originally. I think it's a twin cylinder from memory, a four-stroke twin. Very fashionable machines arrived, nice leg shields and weatherboards, good all-weather machine, and pretty rare to see them today. So that's Mike Dan from Bristol with that Sunbeam scooter. Now, followed by...
Just a quick news, that's so interesting, Neville, but from the organisers, asking exhibitors, unless you really have to, please don't head homeward too early if you can help it. There are still lots of people coming into the rally, and they'd obviously like to see...
Well,
I hear you've got a little collection yourself of...
Oh, right, at the end of the motorcycle sections, I used to get everyone to line up before the end of this drove off.
Anyone wants to do a wheelie, it is allowed, but if you want to rev up, blow your horns, make any sort of noise, you're welcome. It's all part of the appeal. Thank you very much for bringing the machines on, a tremendous variety. Very few following, but the car does the Volvo Mercedes Metro choice in that order can stand by. We've got the helicopter, model helicopter flying display in just a moment.
It's nice to see me actually riding one of some of my scooters, because I've got lots of still pictures of the scooters I've restored over the years, but very rare to see me actually riding one in film. Yep, thanks to Alan Ferrier for taking this.
The Volvo commentary and Mercedes, no doubt. Then we'll be having another commentator from Rolls-Royce, whose name I shall promote again this year. Our thanks to our motorcycle owners. Some of them almost look happy. Well, most of them do, actually.
I'm reliably informed it is the real Steve Brown of Blue Anchor Bay. Renault V-Lane, obviously deaf as a post, that's why he retired, I bet. I used to go and see him when I worked for Renault. Give him a wave, so he's not... Did you recognise me? Yes, will the real Steve Bowden please stand up? Yes, he's waving, yes, he is the real Steve Bowden.
A quick royal wave.
Right, back to Norman Bowden's Isetta and his long mini car, and then Alan Hillier's Trojan. The exposure correct now. On the A30 there, I think that's probably the end, is it? Yeah, from 1995. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this look back at the classic vehicle rally held at Bishopsley in those days, and that you'll be thinking of coming along to the latest one this year, based in Norton Fitzwarren.